Good evening, everyone. Let's discuss endophthalmitis and panophthalmitis today. Both these conditions come under purulent uveitis, and the reason why purulent word is used is because there is a formation of pus, and uveitis because invariably one or more layers of the uvea are involved in such a condition. So both endophthalmitis and panophthalmitis together are called purulent uveitis. Let's get a few definitions clear at this point. Right at the beginning, endophthalmitis is an inflammation of the inner structures of the eyeball. So endophthalmitis, endo, inside, so inner structures. So basically the uvea and the retina is affected with intraocular colonization by infective agents. So one or more agent. It could be a unimicrobial infection or a polymicrobial. It is more commonly polymicrobial, and exudates are seen in the vitreous, anterior chamber and the posterior chamber. Whereas panophthalmitis, when I say the word pan, understand when pan means all the layers are affected. So an inflammation of whole of the eyeball, including the Tenen's capsule as well as the sclera. So the sclera is not as involved in endophthalmitis. In panophthalmitis, sclera is definitely involved. So if you look at the spectrum of diseases, endophthalmitis is sort of lower down on the spectrum, whereas panophthalmitis is on the extreme right. So a severe endophthalmitis will eventually become panophthalmitis if the patient survives that much long enough. So it is a spectrum. Endophthalmitis untreated or undertreated will eventually lead to panophthalmitis. So what causes? So first let's look at endophthalmitis, and let's look at more bacterial, because that is the more common variety. What causes a bacterial endophthalmitis? It could be through two pathways. The first is exogenous, which means the organism is coming from the outside, from the environment. Or endogenous, it is coming from within the eyeball. Exogenous is more common. This is because there is a corneosclerar barrier that is present. So corneal scleral, avascular dense connective tissue, dense collagen tissue that is present, that does not allow organisms to come in through, when they're intact. So when this barrier is broken, that is when it is very likely that organisms will enter. Bacterial is more common than fungal in cases of exogenous endophthalmitis. And minimal systemic findings are found. So what do I mean by systemic findings? I'm talking about fever, about malaise, about pain, about generalized lymphadenopathy. So all those features are less common in case of an exogenous endophthalmitis. So what will possibly produce exogenous introduction of organisms? First and foremost, trauma. So an open globe trauma will more likely cause endophthalmitis as compared to closed globe, for obvious reasons. If the eyeball is burst open, then organisms find it an easier entry pathway, whereas closed globe more refers to the weakening of the existing structures. Most common organism is Staphylococcus epidermidis, but the most specific organism is Bacillus cereus when it comes to trauma. So where all the infection can come from? It can come from a retained intraocular foreign body. And this is especially worse, the outcome as well as the severity of endophthalmitis is worse if the removal of foreign body is delayed to beyond 24 hours. Second is the penetrating material. So for example, if it's a stone, if it is a metallic spike, whatever it may be, that fomite might be infected with an organism. And if that object enters the eyeball, the organism is also going to enter. Lastly, and least commonly, it could be from a contiguous spread from a paranasal sinus. So suppose my maxillary sinus is involved. So maxillary forms, I believe, the floor of the orbital wall. So if the orbital wall fracture, the inferior orbital wall fracture happens, and there is an infection in the paranasal sinus, that infection is going to enter the eyeball in case of a trauma. Less common, but just to remember. So many ophthalmologists prefer having a prophylactic intravitreal antibiotic at the time of intraocular foreign body removal, because understand, almost 1 in 4 patients who have an intraocular foreign body are going to show culture positive reports when the vitreous is removed and taken up for culture sensitivity examination. So a lot of surgeons prefer having an intravitreal antibiotic in the same sitting of surgery. A very interesting phenomenon was noted. A study was conducted in military combat zones where high velocity projectile injuries were studied in the eyeball. And despite a delayed removal of intraocular foreign body, by delayed I mean more than 24 hours from injury, no cases of endophthalmitis were reported. This was believed to be due to an autosterilization phenomenon when you heat, so these high velocity projectiles are usually heated up. These are usually particulate matter from the bullets, from the shrapnel that flies off. So that is at a considerably high temperature. So that high temperature sterilizes the shrapnel, and that sort of burns off all the organisms that is present. So thermal heating produces auto-sterilization, hence no endophthalmitis was noted in this study. Anyway, the next common variety of endophthalmitis, post-cataract surgery. So the incidence is 0.04 to 0.15%. Clear corneal incisions are more likely to produce endophthalmitis as compared to the sclerocorneal incisions, which means phacoemulsification surgery shows a higher risk of developing endophthalmitis as against small incision cataract surgery. And the reasons for these are multiple. First and foremost, a small incision cataract surgery incision is made in a triplanar fashion, which means I enter from the sclera, I go into the cornea, and then I enter the anterior chamber. So it's a triplanar incision. I leave a link at the top of the description to go to the description of small incision cataract surgery, whereas the clear corneal incision is a biplanar incision. It's only in two planes. I leave a link for that as well at the top of the video. So the problem is a triplanar incision is more self-sealing than a biplanar. It is more difficult to obtain self-sealing nature if it is only biplanar. So that produces an increased incidence of endophthalmitis. Next, sutures are very often used when we are operating for small incision cataract surgery. Whereas for phacoemulsification, we do not use sutures. So it's not as, tightly opposing. So in small incision cataract surgery, or even in phaco, it is basically the surgical wound defect that allows the organisms to enter into the anterior chamber. Secondly, it could be due to a posterior capsular rupture. So when there is a posterior capsular tear or a rent, then this organism can gain access to the vitreous. So that again increases the incidence of endophthalmitis. The source of infection is nothing but the periocular flora of the patient. And in cases of pediatric cataracts, there is a higher incidence of endophthalmitis, and also it is more severe as compared to the same organism for the adult. Classically, an acute and a delayed endophthalmitis is described. Acute is less than or equal to 6 weeks within post-surgical time. And the most common organism is the coagulase negative staphylococci group. More specifically, the staph epidermidis. Following which, the next common organism is staph aureus, and then comes streptococci. Delayed happens more than 6 weeks later. And the most classical organism that is described is Propionibacterium acnes. Other risk factors in association with cataract surgery: prolonged surgical time, combined procedure. So when I say combined procedure, it means I'm combining cataract surgery with some other procedure, for example, vitrectomy or a temporarily placed incision. So normally the incision is placed superiorly. However, if it is not possible to place it superiorly, either the conjunctiva has undergone scarring or there is some lid defect over there, some reason you can't place the incision superiorly, the next most commonly placed incision site is temporally. But having a temporal incision exposes the incision to the environment because it is between the two lids. The superior incision is getting covered by the lid, so there is a less incidence of endophthalmitis. Also, one more point I forgot to mention between phacoemulsification and SICS. In a case of SICS tunnel, the sclerocorneal tunnel we make, that is going to be covered by the conjunctiva at the end of surgery, whereas a clear corneal incision is not covered by the conjunctiva because it is exactly on the cornea. It is a clear corneal incision. So there is no conjunctiva on it, so that again predisposes you to having an endophthalmitis. How do you prevent post-surgical endophthalmitis? First and foremost, the most important thing that you have to do is to instill 5% povidone iodine eye drops preoperatively. One or at the most two drops are enough because the conjunctival sac is not of a big volume. Two drops are usually sufficient. You keep it for a duration of 3 minutes to make sure that the povidone iodine is reaching in appropriate locations across the conjunctival sac. Next, lacrimal sac syringing is performed preoperatively. Now this sac syringing is done at least half a day prior to surgery, and adequate painting and draping in the intraoperative stage so that the betadine is spread evenly. It takes care of all the organisms, not just in the eyeball, but also around the orbit, around the nose, around the cheek, around the forehead. So you need a good painting and draping to be done. A short course of oral and topical antibiotics can be given preoperatively. And along with that, at the end of surgery, intracameral antibiotics. When I say intracameral, it means the antibiotic is injected into the anterior chamber. The most commonly utilized antibiotic that we do in our institution is eye drop moxifloxacin, also called brand name Moxisip. Please note, I'm not promoting any brand. This is just the most easily available that we have, which has shown very good results at our levels. The percentage is 0.5% weight by volume. Next common surgery which produces endophthalmitis is penetrating corneal surgeries. This shows the highest risk amongst all intraocular surgeries, simply because, understand, penetrating means there is a full thickness corneal transport. So you are exposing the entire anterior chamber to the environment. So that produces a pretty high risk for the entry of organisms. Not just the large incision, it is also the use of a donor tissue. So another individual's donor tissue is being utilized. In that case, the immune response is going to be pretty strong because it is a transplant procedure. The rate of the incidence is 0.2 to 0.4%, and it is even higher if you are using a keratoprosthesis, which means one of those Boston keratoprostheses. It's basically an implant and it is like a foreign body. So that is going to incite a lot of inflammatory reaction, and that can also be a nidus or a site for accumulation of the organism. So a higher risk if you are using keratoprosthesis. Glaucoma filtration procedures show a 2 to 2.5% risk with each procedure. So the highest risk across all ocular surgeries is a glaucoma filtration procedure, which can produce endophthalmitis. Intraocular surgeries, it is keratoplasty, penetrating keratoplasty, but across ophthalmology, the most risky procedure in terms of endophthalmitis is glaucoma filtration procedures. It shows delayed endophthalmitis more than acute, so consequently, the organism is different as compared to the acute endophthalmitis. There is usually some history of prior blebitis, so the bleb that you form in a glaucoma procedure, you are basically trying to elevate the conjunctiva so that the aqueous is draining into it. So there is some history of inflammation of the bleb that has occurred in the past. The risk factors that increase the incidence of glaucoma, post-glaucoma surgery endophthalmitis, is diabetes mellitus, because diabetes predisposes you to having an infection and having a worse infection compared to a non-diabetic. The use of anti-metabolites, which is quite commonly done in glaucoma filtration procedures to prevent scarring, to prevent fibrosis, because those anti-metabolites prevent the immune system from fighting those organisms that might be present, and an inferior bleb location. Factors that decrease the risk is a fornix-based flap. So there are two kinds of flaps. There is a fornix-based and there is a limbal-based. So basically, it is on the basis of location of where I form the flap. We'll discuss glaucoma filtration surgeries as a separate lecture. But just understand that you need a trapdoor phenomenon. And if the base of that trapdoor is at the fornix, it is called a fornix-based flap. And the exact opposite is a limbal-based flap. Most common organism, Streptococcus pneumoniae. And the next common is Haemophilus influenzae. Vitrectomy surgeries also increase the risk of endophthalmitis. When vitrectomy had begun as a surgical procedure by ophthalmologists, the risk was pretty high because you're directly accessing the vitreous. But you can reduce the risk by conjunctival displacement, which means basically covering the site of vitrectomy with a conjunctiva. So it doesn't allow the organisms to enter. It makes it more difficult for the organism to enter. Biplanar incision, the concept is very similar to phacoemulsification surgery. You are trying to make a self-sealing wound, and use of sutures wherever necessary. If you feel that the wound is not self-sealing, then you will have to suture the site of incision. Intravitreal injections also increase the risk for the same reason. And that is simply because vitrectomy also involves access into the vitreous cavity, and intravitreal injections do the same. Naturally, steroids show an increased incidence of endophthalmitis as compared to anti-vascular endothelial growth factors, because steroids, in addition to producing some mild sterile inflammation in the vitreous, also inhibits the immune system of the body. So the risk is 0.87% for triamcinolone, which is a steroid, and anti-VEGF, the risk is much lesser, which is 0.02 to 0.04%. So the basic risk and the basic mechanism is that introduction of common cells in the eyeball happens. So here is where painting and draping comes into play. So we have spoken about exogenous, and now let's look at endogenous endophthalmitis. It is also called metastatic. Please note, when I say metastatic in this case, it is not relation to any tumor or any neoplasm. It basically means that there is an infection somewhere else in the body, and that infection or that infective material is metastasizing to the eyeball. The most common route of spread is hematogenous. And it's very often an immunosuppressed patient, the IV drug abuser. Patients of cardiac valvular disease, for example, multiple sclerosis very commonly could show, a disseminated infection. Dental caries or other persistent infections. So somewhere infection is present in the body, that infection is spreading to the eyeball. Here in endogenous, the most common type of organisms is fungal more than bacterial. Exogenous, it was bacterial more than fungal. In endogenous, the most common class of organisms is fungal. However, if you see a bacterial infection, it is more likely to be gram negative as compared to gram positive. Western world, gram positive cases are seen more often, but Asian countries and the rest of the countries, which includes India, gram negative is more commonly seen. Diabetes is the most common comorbidity, and it shows an increased risk for coagulase negative organism endophthalmitis. It not only increases the risk, but also increases the severity of endophthalmitis. It is much more difficult to treat a diabetic endophthalmitis than a non-diabetic endophthalmitis. So just as at a glance, these are the organisms that you should need to remember, gram-positive as well as gram-negative, in roughly this sequence of incidence. Staph epidermidis and Pseudomonas aeruginosa are the most common organisms in gram-positive and gram-negative respectively. The rest of the organisms are in sequence. So what exactly goes wrong? The organism enters the vitreous cavity. There is an increase in intravitreal cytokines, such as TNF-alpha, IL-1 beta, interferon gamma. So one of the pathological biomarkers, a couple of them increase. There is a neutrophil aggregation. And naturally, when there is a neutrophil aggregation for a prolonged period of time, there is going to be suppurative inflammation, which is followed by tissue necrosis. So the left side image, if you can notice the arrow, there is one shiny disc-like structure that is seen in the histopathology sample. And that is basically the IOL, the intraocular lens that was implanted after cataract surgery. So this is a sample of a post-cataract surgery, acute post-operative endophthalmitis. The right side image, you can see I don't know if it is very clear, but that is the haptic of the intraocular lens. When intraocular lens has two parts, there is an optic and a haptic. The left side image shows the haptic part of the IOL. Okay, what clinical features is the patient going to present to you with? A very important study called the endophthalmitis vitrectomy study was performed a couple of years ago. And that the primary aim of that study was to talk about the treatment modalities for post-operative endophthalmitis. But it also spoke a lot about the clinical features that a patient of endophthalmitis can present with. So the four classical features: decreased vision, conjunctival congestion, pain, and lid swelling. So one or more of the features are present. All of them may not be present at the same time in the same patient, but at least one of these will present, one of these four classical features. The next features that may or may not be present is hypopyon, white plaque on the posterior capsule, fibrin strands, vitritis, keratic precipitates, and cystoid macular edema. Again, all of these may not be present. It depends on which part of the eyeball is affected, but eventually one or more of these features will be seen in a case of endophthalmitis. Siddle's test can be performed. So the right side image is a Siddle's test. What I basically do is instill a fluorescein dye in the conjunctival sac. Suppose I have performed cataract surgery for a patient before doing Siddle's test. And if I see that this fluorescein dye is getting diluted around the site of incision, it means there is some fluid that is coming from inside the eyeball to the outside and diluting this dye. So this fluid is nothing but the aqueous humor, and if I see such a phenomenon, then there is a leakage of aqueous humor from the anterior chamber. So this is called a positive Siddle's test. It means there is a patent communication between the environment and the anterior chamber. The next thing that you should look for, this is especially in cases of posterior capsular rent, you can have vitreous in the wound. So vitreous basically comes from behind the posterior capsular rent and gets blocked off and blocks off the corneal, clear corneal incisions you have made in phacoemulsification surgery. So that is something that you should look for in a case of phaco surgery or even SICS surgery with a posterior capsular rent. What investigations would I like to perform? First and foremost is a B-scan. So B-scan is an ultrasound of the for the entire eyeball, especially to look at the posterior segment. I want you to look at the patterns of fungal endophthalmitis and bacterial endophthalmitis. Look at the growth. So the left side is the anterior part and the right side is the posterior part. So the posterior most growth that you see, the fungating growth that you see, that is the exudate of fungal endophthalmitis. And it actually appears like a mushroom shape, or it grows into the vitreous. Compared that to bacterial, the bacterial exudate is more flatter. It is more sticking to the retina or the subretinal region. It is not growing into the vitreous. So this is a very characteristic difference between the two. The other investigations I can do is blood cultures. So when I'm planning for blood cultures, I need to get samples. I need to get samples of the organism. So I can do an aqueous or a vitreous sampling. aqueous volume is aqueous volume is lesser as compared to vitreous requirement. The aqueous required is only 0.1 to 0.2 ml, and a 25 gauge cannula is utilized, whereas the vitreous a little more is required, 0.2 to 0.4 milliliters with a 23 gauge needle. So aqueous sampling is much easier as compared to vitreous, because I can do a simple paracentesis, just like making a side port incision of SICS, and collect the aqueous. 2D echo can be advised as and when required. So suppose you are expecting this to be a patient of some cardiac valvular disease, you are suspecting bacterial endocarditis, in those cases 2D echo can be utilized, and a cardiologist opinion is validated. Microbiology aspect. First and foremost, Gram stain, it's a very rapid test that can be done, and it is extremely useful in deciding the treatment modalities. Plus culture sensitivity. Culture sensitivity takes time. It takes a couple of days to a couple of weeks, depending on what organism we are looking for. And again, the sample could be an aqueous paracentesis, vitreous aspirate, or a pars plana vitrectomy sample. One thing you have to understand, Propionibacterium acnes is a chronic endophthalmitis, a delayed endophthalmitis causing organism. So the incubation also has to be longer. It needs to be incubated minimum for a duration of 14 days. And if all else fails, then PCR is always available. You need a half to one sized organism for performing a PCR, that is polymerase chain reaction. And that is going to help you in the diagnosis of the organism. So there's a lot of differential diagnosis available. Before labeling a patient as endophthalmitis, there's a lot of things that you need to consider. But the most important differential diagnosis you need to consider is a toxic anterior segment syndrome, also sometimes written in short as TAS. So TAS is basically a differential for endophthalmitis in which the inflammation is limited only to the anterior segment. Beyond the posterior capsule of the lens, nothing is affected. The vitreous is absolutely clear. And the TAS is basically an inflammatory reaction or an allergic reaction to the chemicals that we use, to the antibiotics or to the balanced salt solution or Ringer lactate that we use as a hydrating agent. Or it could be due to an inflammation reaction to the retained lens matter. So understand that the lens tissue is sequestered. It is packed inside the lens capsule. So when you expose it to the environment and accidentally you leave some amount of lens matter, which may be common because sometimes microscopic fibers can be left behind, that is when TAS occurs. So TAS is a non-infectious condition, whereas endophthalmitis is infectious. The onset is much earlier. It is between 12 to 24 hours post-surgical time, whereas endophthalmitis is a little later. Classically, it starts between 4th and 7 days of post-surgical day. The treatment of endophthalmitis, it is an ophthalmological emergency. You cannot delay it for any reason. You cannot delay it for microbiology results. You cannot delay it for the lack of resources. It is an emergency, one of the few conditions in ophthalmology where you have to undertake immediate treatment. The objectives are firstly to control the infection, second to manage the complication, and third to restore vision. So it is in this sequence that you need to conduct your management. So consequently, you cannot assure the patient of any vision in the postoperative in the due course of clinical course of endophthalmitis. Vision restoration comes much later. First and foremost, you need to control the infection, and a written consent needs to be taken to the patient in the language of his or her choice, and explain to them that we are not trying to worry about vision right now. We are more worried about the infection, and that is what we are going to control. Vision restoration is not a guarantee. Vision restoration may or may not happen. That is not our aim. Our aim is to control the infection and manage the complication. So a guarded visual prognosis needs to be taken from the patient, and this has medico-legal significance later on in the course of disease. First and foremost, the cornerstone of treatment is an intravitreal antibiotic. Vancomycin is utilized for gram-positive organisms, whereas ceftazidime is used for gram-negative. Ceftazidime belongs to the cephalosporin group of antibiotics, and very often it shows allergic reaction in a lot of patients. So amikacin, which is an aminoglycoside, can be utilized as an alternative. It is more toxic to the retina and the macula, but in cases where there is allergy to ceftazidime, we do not have an option. We have to proceed with caution. Intravitreal steroids, a little controversial. The problem is there is so much inflammation in the eyeball, not all of it is directed to destroying the organism. Some of the inflammation also destroys the normal surrounding tissue. So to reduce that, an intravitreal corticosteroid injection can be given. This is always after an antibiotic injection and very useful in cases of staph aureus, staph epidermidis, and bacillus cereus. Bacillus cereus, if you remember, is the most specific organism for traumatic exogenous endophthalmitis. And the drug that we use is dexamethasone, which is especially useful for delayed bleb-associated endophthalmitis. So when I say delayed onset endophthalmitis, it means that the organism is likely to be of a low virulence. So in these cases, intravitreal steroids could be useful. Systemic antibiotics are started empirically, cefotaxime 1 gram IV twice daily and amikacin 500 milligrams IV twice daily. Topical antibiotics are also utilized. This could be fortified ceftazidime 5% with fortified vancomycin 5%. So when I say fortified, it means the strength of these antibiotics is stronger than the conventional available or over-the-counter chemist supplied antibiotics, and that fortification is required because that much more strength of antibiotics is required to take care of endophthalmitis. Regular antibiotics are useful for conjunctivitis, but in cases of endophthalmitis and as well keratitis, you need fortification of the antibiotic. The next modality of treatment is pars plena vitrectomy. And when I say pars plena vitrectomy, I'm also giving an intravitreal injection. It is very rarely done alone. The indication for pars plena vitrectomy is a severe inflammatory reaction. When I say severe, I mean the patient is having a loss of vision. There is a loss of a red reflex of the choroid. There is severe inflammation. There is so much exudate coming out from the surgical wounds. Or if it is a gram negative organism on culture studies, then pars plena vitrectomy is indicated. If there is a vitreous abscess, so abscess anywhere in the body needs to be drained, and the way to drain a vitreous abscess is to perform a pars plena vitrectomy. The only way you can remove the abscess is to remove the vitreous along with it. And finally, if it is not responding to medical or intravitreal therapy, it is not indicated in all patients. It is only indicated in these four specific conditions. The purpose is to obtain tissue for diagnosis, because when I perform vitrectomy, I can remove the vitreous and send it for microbiological examination. And it also reduces the pro-inflammatory debris. It removes the organism, it removes the infected vitreous, and it also removes the inflammatory reaction that is present around the organism. This is where the endophthalmitis vitrectomy study comes into play. If the patient's vision is PL present, only perception of light present, then visual outcome of such a patient improves when you perform pars plena vitrectomy along with an intravitreal injection. Whereas if the vision of the patient is hand movements or better, which means it is slightly better than PL present, then there is absolutely no benefit of performing additional vitrectomy with intravitreal injection. In such patients who have hand movements or better, intravitreal injections are sufficient to restore vision. Finally, you will remove the intraocular lens in one condition and one condition only. That is when it is a Propionibacterium macneese infection which is not responding to regular therapy. What signs am I hoping to see in such a patient? It is the contraction of exudate, it is a decrease in cells in the anterior chamber, and a decrease in hypopyon. And what factors do I not want to see? I don't want to see a virulent organism. I do not want this patient to present late to me. I do not want it to be within 2 days of post-operative day of surgery. The vision is PL present or worse. So when I say PL present and worse, it means PL present and PL negative. If there is relative afferent pupillary defect, that means the optic nerve is now starting to get involved. If it is a diabetic, it is going to make it more difficult to manage such a patient, because I have to manage the endophthalmitis as well as the blood sugar of such a patient. Drug resistance again hinders treatment, and children. So children particularly show a more virulent response as compared to adults for the same organism. This might be because of a hyperactive immune system.